Hi guys, and welcome back to my channel. So today we're going to be talking about completing the square, and this is just my take on how I like to complete the square. There's a lot of different little infographics and tricks and ways that I've seen different people do this online, so feel free to go with someone else's interpretation. I'll just give you the way I like to do it. So what would we typically complete the square on? We would complete the square definitely on things that are quadratic in form. So that's not always necessarily going to look exactly like ax squared plus bx plus c, but it'll be things that have the square pattern of having a squared term, a middle term that is half the exponent of the leading term, and then a constant. And when we do what's called completing the square, we'd be taking something that's a standard form quadratic and we'd be completing the square to turn it into something that is like a times x minus h squared plus k. And we would call this a square because we have our square term here and we're just adding a constant. So one reason that this particular format is useful is because you can see your vertex very clearly. Your vertex for this quadratic would be hk. But we'll also frequently complete the square for other reasons. I can think of a few, such as conic sections is going to be what we're talking about in this video. But we'd also complete the square when we want to find the inverse of certain quadratic type functions. That would be helpful. So let's take a look at some specific examples. We're going to start with a completely general quadratic so you guys can just see the process for how this goes. And I know that it's probably a little weird to see this with constants, but I do think it'll be helpful, and then we'll take a look at an example with specific numbers. So we start off with our quadratic ax squared plus bx plus c. And the first step that I like to do is I like to factor out the leading coefficient. So I'll factor out the a from the first two terms. So it's really not necessary to factor it out from the third, so I don't tend to do that. So I factor my a out, that's why I have those parentheses there. And you see, when I multiply that a back in, I haven't changed the quadratic at all. I'm just changing how it looks, step by step by step. So every line is equivalent to the previous, and it should stay that way. We shouldn't do anything that actually changes the quadratic, because we're just changing how it's written. Okay, so now I kind of have in my mind what I know the format that I'm looking for is. I want to have x plus or minus some term squared, and then there will be a constant. So knowing that, I'm going to be focusing on what's inside my parentheses. So I'll frequently say, okay, we're always completing the square. We do that step within the parentheses. So I'm going to pay attention to these two terms here. So I'll copy the a, the parentheses down, and my plus c. And then within the parentheses, I know that the pattern is going to be I should have x plus or minus some number squared, and then plus or minus some number. So knowing that pattern, I want to think about when I square something, there's going to be an x. I want to square something that's going to, when I actually do the FOIL, I want to actually end up with b over a. So when you square something, what that does is it takes that constant and you end up getting two times that for the middle term. So I know that if I go with plus b over 2a, I should be able to get back to b over ax when I square it. So I'm going to check out that pattern and make sure that it was correct. Okay, so I've got x and I've got b over 2a. Now this little box is how I like to visually demonstrate the distribution process, which a lot of people like to use FOIL, and that's okay too. So x times x is x squared, x times b over 2a is b over 2ax, x, I'm keeping it the same, b over 2ax, and then b times b is b squared, 2a times 2a is 4a squared. Okay, so let's take a look at what we get when we actually add these together. When we add together our two middle boxes here, b over 2a plus b over 2a gives me 2b over 2a, which is just b over a x. So check, we got to our middle term. And then what was extra that was added on is this red square here. That's extra. So you'll notice if we look back at our original in the parentheses, so I'm looking over here, x squared plus b over ax, that b squared over 4a squared, That's extra. So I've actually changed the quadratic by doing x plus b over 2a squared, and I don't want to change the quadratic. I'm just changing how it's looking. So because that's a positive, b squared over 4a squared, I'm going to take it away. Okay, and the reason that I'm taking that away is because I want to make sure that these two lines are equivalent to each other. So if I were to actually multiply it out, we did the x plus b over 2a squared, that's this whole box, and when we take away that red box, we get x plus b over 2a squared minus b squared over 4a squared. We get back to our original. Okay, so that's one reason why people will frequently call this completing the square, because the only term that we're off is that last third box when we do that process, and so that's our correction factor every time. Okay, so now we're almost to the format that we want. It's just not quite as clean as we want it, so we'll distribute that a back in and we'll simplify things. So when I distribute the a, I get a times x plus b over 2a squared minus b squared a over 4a squared plus c. Okay, well, I can simplify this fraction. So that would be a times x plus b over 2a squared minus b squared over 4a plus c. Okay. There's a lot of cool things that we could actually conclude from this process of completing the square, but I want to keep this video fairly focused. And I'll just say that the process that we just did is how one could actually go about deriving the quadratic formula. So this would be a way that someone could actually prove the quadratic formula. Leaving it at that, here's our format. Okay, so we just completed the square on basically any quadratic. Let's take a look at doing this with a specific example with some numbers. So we'll take a look at B and just go over that process again with some specific values. 5x squared minus 2x minus 1. So I begin the process by factoring out my leading term from the first two terms. Okay. And then the pattern that some people like to remember is they do half it, square it. That's the pattern. So it goes half of 2/5. Half of 2/5 is 2/10, or aka 1/5. And you square it, and then you take away the square of 1/5. Okay, that pattern is going to be consistent every time, because we just saw with our completely general first example that it's always going to be taking the half of the middle term and then squaring it gives you this red box here that we took off. So this pattern of half it, square it, and let's highlight this. This is always going to be negative. And some people get a little confused on this sign here. This sign should match the coefficient above. So it should be matching. Okay, so now let's clean this up. Distributing that 5 in, we get 5 times x minus 1/5 squared minus 1/5 minus 1. And there's our completed square version of this. Okay, so let's go on and let's take a look at another case where we're frequently wanting to complete the square, which is when we're looking at standard form of conic sections. So for example, we can tell by looking at this is going to be probably a conic section. I can see that the x term is squared, the y term is squared, and it just has that feeling to me, right? So taking a look at this, even though someone doesn't necessarily say something, the fact that they're saying put this into a standard form for a conic, it implies the fact that you want to have certain patterns. So as we've seen in the conic sections video, the standard form of conics is to have basically completed square versions of your x and y terms. So we'll separate the x and y terms out. And we're going to complete the square on them separately. Okay, so completing the square on the x's, we're going to factor out that leading coefficient, 5. Okay, now completing the square on the inside, we do half the middle term, so x minus 2 squared, half it, and then square it. And let's do the same thing for y. So we factor the 3 out. Then we do half the middle term, y, negative 2 divided into 2 is negative 1, and then we do minus 1. So then distributing that out, we get 5x minus 2 squared minus 20, and we get 3y minus 1 squared minus 3. Now we're going to put that back into our original equation. So we get 5x minus 2 squared minus 20 plus 3y minus 1 squared minus 3 equals negative 8. And cleaning this up, we add, it looks like we'll add 20. We'll add 3, so we're adding 23 total to the right, and that would give me 23 minus 8 would be 15. Okay, so for conics, we're thinking about circles, ellipses, hyperbolas, and we want to have an equals 1 on the right-hand side, so I don't want that 15. I will divide both sides by it. Okay, and then we simplify our fractions. So our first fraction is this 5 over 15. So that's going to simplify to x minus 2 squared over 3. And then our second fraction is this 3y minus 1 squared over 15. So that'll simplify to a fifth. And we get 1 over here. So now we can analyze this, and we see that these two numbers on the bottom, let me highlight the 3 and the 5, they're different values. There's a positive in between. That would indicate that this is not a circle, but rather an ellipse. And after you've done a certain amount of completing this square, it's definitely possible to know in advance that you're going to get an ellipse. So like, I've had a lot of practice, and I can look at that original expression without anything done yet and tell that, yes, it's going to end up being an ellipse. There's an awesome video that Math is Power for You put out on how to do that I would definitely check out if you are interested in that. So hopefully this has been helpful for completing this square, and I'll see you guys next time.